students, in the previous classes we have had a look at viscous damping, in which case force of that damper which was provided by the damper was proportional to the velocity and proportionality constant was nothing but C. Okay. Now in this particular class we are going to consider a different damping mechanism which is called as a Coulomb damping, and it is observed when there is a dry friction between two surfaces which are having relative motion with respect to each other. So it is either called as a dry friction damping or Coulomb damping. So yeah, either this word or that word. Okay. Now as we already have considered, there is a mass block which is attached over here to the fixed wall using a spring. But now in this case there is no any roller system over here, but mass block is directly resting on the ground and there is a friction between this mass block and the ground. So as you already are aware of, what is the force of friction? That is equal to mu times n, and it acts in the opposite direction as that of the relative velocity between these two surfaces. Okay, so if velocity is in this direction, frictional force will be acting in this direction and vice versa. So friction force in nutshell can be written as mu times, which is this coefficient of friction, mu times n, which is this normal reaction n, which typically happens to be equal to mg. Okay? This is the typical expression. Okay, need not always be. Okay, so mu times n times sine of, so whatever is the sine of x dot, opposite to that is what is the force, frictional force, which will be offered by this particular damping mechanism. So what are the total forces which are acting on the mass block? Now if let's say we try to draw the free body diagram of it, then all forces which are acting on it are Fs and this frictional force. Okay, so this is a spring force. Let me directly write down the expression. So, spring force expression is minus kx, and the expression of this one is minus mu n sine of x dot. Okay, this is either called a signum function, or it is essentially the sine of x dot. So whatever sine that x dot is having, we have to take care of that sine. Okay, and this is what is the expression. So let me tell you how exactly this signum function looks like. Okay, so let's say you have x over here and you are plotting this sine of x dot, sorry, we have x dot over here. Okay, so when x dot is negative, this function will give you minus 1 value, and the moment x dot becomes positive, it will give you 1. Okay, and at this level, at x is equal to 0, obviously there is a discontinuity in this function. Okay, so this function has got these two values. So either it will take this value or it will take this value, depending on what is the sine of this x dot. Okay, so for all those sine, for all those x dot values which are negative, you are going to get minus 1 as output of this. Okay, and when x dot is positive, what you are going to get is plus 1. Okay, so this is what is happening when x dot is greater than 0, that is when x dot is positive. Okay, so this is what is a signum function, and this function is non-linear in nature. Okay, so what do we mean by non-linear function? Okay, so non-linearity means that this function, let's say if you operate on 1 and in the other case you operate it on 2 and sum it up, then will it be equal to same function operated on 3? No, it won't be. Because this will give value equal to 1, this will give value equal to 1, and this also gives value equal to 1. However, for any linear function, this thing doesn't happen. So it should have resulted into 1 plus 1 equal to 2. Okay. So for example, kx is a linear function. So k into 1, when x is equal to 1, you evaluate this function, which happens to be equal to k into 1. You evaluate this function when x is equal to 2, which happens to be equal to k into 2, and then you evaluate this at 3, then you get this. So this holds. So this function evaluated at 1, this function evaluated at 2, if you sum them up, you get to see the same function evaluated at 3. Okay, so this property is called as linearity. Okay, this ensures that the function is linear. However, the signum function that you are seeing over here is non-linear in nature. Okay, so whatever spring force that we are getting over here is essentially a non-linear spring force. So we have to write down this equation of motion, which is non-linear in nature. So what we'll get is mx double dot is equal to minus kx minus mu times n times sine of x dot, okay, which essentially means that mx double dot plus kx plus mu n sine of x dot is equal to 0. This is what is equation of motion, which is non-linear in nature, and solving non-linear equations is no less than a nightmare. So what do we do? Okay, so what we do is we kind of use a trick over here. So we divide this entire equation of motion, which is valid over entire domain of x dot, so we kind of write it over in this way. So equation of motion, I'll be writing it in this form: mx double dot plus kx minus mu n equal to 0 for all those values of x dot which are smaller than 0, right? Whereas the same equation of motion would look like this: for all those values of x dot which are greater than 0, right? So this equation of motion, rather than writing this unified equation of motion, what I've done is I've written two equations of motion. So it's like your domain of x dot is ranging from negative side to positive side. So what you are doing is, over this side you are writing this equation of motion, and when you are towards this side of the x dot domain, at that time you are kind of using this equation of motion. Okay, so in that way, what we have done is we have divided, or we have kind of distributed this single equation into these two differential equations, and each one of these two differential equations, if you see, each one of them is a linear one. So the first equation, which is mx double dot plus kx equal to mu n, is a linear equation. So as long as you are over here in this domain, you are going to see this equation, which is linear in nature. And in the other case, which is this one, you are going to see another equation, which happens to be again a linear equation. So one single nonlinear equation has been divided into two linear equations. So this is at times also called as piecewise linearity. Okay, so for example, it may so happen that this is how the function looks like. Okay, so it is linear over here, it is linear over here, but if you see function as a whole, it is nonlinear in nature. Right. So in that case, what you can do is you can consider this domain in one case, and in the next case you consider this domain and ensure continuity over here, and that time you can solve the system. Okay, so that's what we are doing over here as well. Okay, so we are utilizing the piecewise linear property of it. Okay, now our job is to kind of solve these two differential equations. Okay, with initial conditions, which are given as, so let's kind of pick one typical initial condition, set of initial conditions. Okay, so let me consider that initial condition where x at time t equal to 0 is, let's say, x0, and x dot, that is velocity at time t equal to 0, is equal to x dot 0. So what does this mean? Okay, so this means that you are kind of, so this, if this is the mass block, okay, in the equilibrium position, so what you are doing is you are kind of extending it over here. This is the new position of the mass block. Okay, this is x0. Okay, and mass block is at rest when it is over here, and you are kind of letting it go with no, so at the time when you kind of release this mass block, at that time there is no any initial velocity, let this be 0. Okay, so this is what is the initial condition that we are considering, that there is initial displacement which is equal to x0, and there is no any initial velocity. So x dot 0, let's consider to be equal to 0. Okay, so it is starting from its right extremity. So the mass block, when it started its journey, was towards its right extremity. Okay, so this is what is the initial condition that we are considering, and now our job is to solve this set of equations. We have two equations over here. So this equation, when x is small, x dot is smaller than 0, and the other equation, which is this one, when x dot is larger than 0. Now let's go back to this system that we have picked up. So what is the system? System is this one, in which mass is starting its journey at time t equal to 0 from its right extremity. So where is mass moving? Mass is moving towards here. Okay, right now mass is towards its right extremity. After some time, mass will go over here and take the left extreme position, and then it will come back towards the right extremity. Now let's consider the first half cycle, when mass is traveling from its right extremity towards its left extremity. At that time, mass is in this journey, okay, so from right to left, which essentially means that velocity in that case is negative, right? Velocity is smaller than 0, right? So what you have is this equation. So we have to solve this equation, which is mx double dot plus kx equal to mu n, with initial conditions that initial displacement first, x at time t equal to 0 is x0 and x dot at time t equal to 0 is 0. Okay, so these are two initial conditions. Now we have so far kind of solved these such kind of equations, okay? We have solved this equation with such kind of initial conditions. What is the difference between this equation that we already have solved and this equation that we are right now attempting to solve? The difference is towards over here, okay, which is right hand side of this equation. In this case, which we already have solved, which we have seen, at that time there was 0 over here. This is called as homogeneous equation, and this is, let me write it as h, and this is non-homogeneous equation. Okay, so here you have non-zero term sitting over here, so that's why this equation is termed as non-homogeneous differential equation, whereas this equation is homogeneous differential equation. So homogeneous differential equation, we already have seen how to attempt the solution of that, but now this is slightly a different case, and we need to see how exactly we can find out solution of this non-homogeneous differential equation. You might have already done it in your maths classes, however I'll be telling you once again. Okay, so let me rewrite that non-homogeneous equation over here. So this is the non-homogeneous equation that we are trying to solve, and these are the initial conditions. Okay, so this is not the only thing that we need to ensure. We need to ensure these initial conditions as well. So what we do is we write down this x, we break this x into two parts. We say that x is equal to x1 plus x2, okay, where we call x1 as complementary solution and x2 as particular integral. Okay, so x2 is termed as a particular integral and x1 is termed as a complementary solution. Now what these two terms are? So what this x2 is doing is that x2 will take care of this. So let me kind of tell you it in slightly different fashion. So what we'll do is we'll plug in this expression of x into this one. Okay, so what we'll get is mx1 double dot plus kx1 plus mx2 double dot plus kx2 equal to mu n. Okay, so you have this term, this set of terms sitting over here, and this set of terms sitting over here, which are in terms of x2, and this is in terms of x1. Okay, so and this side also you can write down as mu n plus 0. Okay, so what we do is we divide this one single equation, once again this equation, into two equations. Okay, so one equation is mx2 double dot plus kx2 equal to mu n, and other equation is mx1 double dot plus kx1 equal to 0. So what we have obtained, still mu n is sitting over here. So what is a big deal? Whatever that we have done, what is big deal in that? Big deal is that Now, I'll be saying that x2 can be anything. It doesn't have to take care of initial conditions. It just shouldn't worry about what initial conditions are. Without giving any regard to initial conditions, you have to just find out any x2. Okay, just go and find out any x2 that can solve this equation. Just disregard initial conditions. Don't be obsessed with those initial conditions. We'll be taking care of those initial conditions over here. Okay, so here in this case, you just don't have to worry about. Okay, so if I do so, so what is x2 that I can think of? What is the simplest x2 that I can think of? So x2 can be equal to mu n by k. Right? So in that case, x2 double dot will be equal to 0. The first term will be 0. Second term will be equal to k times mu n by k. And that happens to be equal to mu n, and hence equation is solved. So this choice of x2 can indeed solve this equation. Okay, so I have picked up x2 which is constant in nature, so I don't have to worry whether this x2 is going to satisfy initial conditions or not. Okay, that is something, that headache I have kind of taken out for time being. Okay, and now in the next step I'll be finding out x1. This x1 you already have found out. Okay, now this x1 should have two floating constants. Okay, so x1 should have two floating constants which will ensure that your initial conditions are satisfied. In order to do that, we will be using the same method, that we'll be using x1 as e^λt, and we know that in that case we found out x1 as a cosine omega t minus phi, right? We already have found out this for this kind of condition. Okay, so we should have two floating constants. So we have one constant a and other constant phi. Okay, so this is what is the expression of x1, this is what is the expression of x2, and you know that you have, this is what you have chosen, x to be equal to x1 plus x2, which essentially means that what you have found out is x, which is equal to a cosine omega t minus phi plus mu n by k, right? So this is, so what is going to happen when you are going to plug this expression of x into differential equation, this term that will ensure that this is what is that term, so that will be equal to 0, and this term will ensure that this balances with this, right? So differential equation is satisfied. Now, in order to satisfy initial conditions, you are going to evaluate this x at time t equal to 0. You are going to differentiate it and find out what is going to be the x dot, and again evaluate that at time t equal to 0 and ensure the initial condition is satisfied. So by doing this or by following this path, what you have done is you have found out particular integral first without giving any regard to initial conditions. Then you have found out this complementary solution which should have those many floating constants as many initial conditions that you have, and then you are going to balance out those initial conditions using these constants that those are over here. Okay, so let me try to ensure that initial conditions are satisfied in our case as well. So let me evaluate x at time t equal to 0. So what will be the expression of x at time t equal to 0? It will be equal to a cosine of minus phi, which happens to be equal to phi, plus mu n by k, and this should be equal to x0. Let me name this equation as equation number 1. Okay, now I will have to find out velocity using this expression. I have displacement expression with me. If I find out velocity will be equal to, this will get differentiated in this fashion, minus a omega sine of omega t minus phi. And if you differentiate this term, there won't be any contribution coming from that differentiation because it will be 0. So this is what is the expression of x dot, and if you evaluate that x dot at time t equal to 0, then what you will get is a omega n, it is actually, this is omega n over here, so you know that, so omega is omega n, right? So it will be A omega n times sin phi. Sin of minus phi is minus sin phi. You have one minus sign over here. So those two minus signs get cancelled with each other. And what you get is A omega n sin phi. Okay. Which means, so what are two conditions that you have obtained? And this is equal to x dot 0. Okay. So first condition has given you x 0 is equal to A cos phi plus mu n by k, okay, and the other, which essentially, let me explain it further, or let me reduce it further. So it comes out to be equal to A cos phi equal to x 0 minus mu n by k. This is the reduced form of equation number 1, and the equation number 2 is A sin phi equal to 0. So this will happen when phi will be equal to 0. Okay? So which means that phi is 0 over here. Okay, so what I'll do is, and a square in that case will be equal to x0 minus mu n, or a in itself will be equal to x0 minus mu n by k. Okay. Therefore, x that you have obtained in this case is equal to x0 minus mu n by k, this is amplitude, times cosine of omega n t, phi is not there as it is 0, plus mu n by k. This is what is the expression of x when mass is moving from its right extreme position to left extreme position. That means that when mass has got displacement, velocity smaller than 0, and when mass is in its first half cycle, so when mass has just started its motion from right extreme to left extreme. Okay, so let me try to plot this. Okay, so how are we going to plot this? You first of all look at this one. Okay, so let me try to plot that function. So what is this function? This is oscillatory in nature. It starts from x0 minus, this is x0 minus mu n by k. It starts from here. Okay. It is oscillatory in nature with this cosine function. Right. This is what is going to be the behavior of it. And this is the period, which is equal to 2 pi over omega n. Okay. This is amplitude x0 minus mu n by k. On the negative side also, what this what will be this height? This will be equal to minus of x0 minus mu n over k. Right? So this is the first term that you have plotted over here. But you have one more term sitting over here, which is this. Okay. So what is this? This is a constant number, which is this way. Okay. So what you have to do is you have to sum these two things. Essentially, in that case, your system's response will be like this. Okay. It will start from x0. As what you will be doing is you will be shifting this cosine curve. Whatever cosine curve that you see over here, what you have to do is you have to just shift that cosine curve in the positive direction. By how much amount? By this amount, mu n by k. So if you shift it in this direction, amplitude will be equal to, or the topmost point will be equal to x0. Amplitude is still this one, x0 minus mu n by k. Only thing is that it has, this cosine curve has shifted. There is a DC shift. This we call as DC shift. Okay. So there is some constant value which is getting added over here. Okay. And hence, on the other side, this cosine curve will terminate slightly early. So this side, what you will get? This side you will get as x0 minus 2 mu n over k, right? And this curve is valid only in the first cycle, right? This is the expression of x. This is how the function of x looks like, okay, in the first cycle. It started from x0, it ended over here at x0 minus 2n 2 mu n by k. So how far left extreme is going to be from this mean position? It is going to be at this distance, okay? This is minus sign. There is going to be a minus sign over here, okay? So what has happened is that, so your mass was initially over here at the mean position, at the rest position, okay? You kind of pulled this mass over here at this end, which was x0 units away in this direction, and let it vibrate. So at the end of first half cycle, this mass did not reach to minus x0, but it kind of terminated its first half cycle at minus of x0 minus 2 mu n by k. Okay, so this side, if you see, what is the reduction in the displacement that you have obtained? So the first half cycle has ended up in 2 mu n by k units of reduction in the displacement, right? However, if you see to it, this curve is still harmonic, okay, with frequency equal to mu n. Okay, this is the story of first half cycle itself. Okay, we are yet to start with the second half cycle. So what has happened is that mass has started its journey from right extremity, went to the left extremity, and now its second journey has got started from left extremity towards the right extremity. Now in that second journey, what is going to happen is that, in that case, x dot will be larger than 0. X dot is larger than 0, and hence the equation of motion, which is now going to be the valid equation, is this way. Okay. Now what we'll do is, we'll kind of assume, okay, so we are over here now. So this is the time axis and we are over here. So at how much off we are t by 2 units away from this t equal to 0. So what is t by 2? It is equal to pi over omega. So we are pi over omega units away over here along this time axis. So we have marched this much amount of distance along time axis. So now what I'll do is, for this next half cycle, which I haven't drawn over here, which is I am yet to draw. So for that next half cycle, I will assume a new time axis whose zero will start from here. Okay, so I'll assume a new time axis t1 whose zero will start from here. So t1 will now be equal to t minus pi by omega. Okay, so whatever t1 is appearing over here, that is this one. Okay, so for that new time axis, now this is entirely a new set of new entire system that we have to consider, where this is a new time axis t1. Okay, and where is mass now? Mass is towards its left extremity, which is equal to minus of x0 minus 2 mu n over k. Okay, so this is what is x0. Mass is over here and it has to start its journey from here. And what is x dot 0 at that location? That is equal to 0. Okay, so what I'll say is, it has got new initial conditions. This is the differential equation, and I'll be writing down new initial conditions. So this is the differential equation of the system for second half cycle, where mass is coming from its left extremity towards the right extremity. This is the differential equation and initial conditions. I'll be writing down new initial conditions, that x at t1 equal to 0 should be equal to minus of x0 minus 2 mu n over k. Okay, and x dot at t1 equal to 0 should be equal to 0. So this is what is the set of conditions that we have. We will be solving this entire system in terms of t1, and then that t1 we are going to change into t. Okay, so they are going to follow exactly the same procedure. So we'll be writing down x as a combination of complementary solution plus particular integral. In this case, particular integral is going to be equal to minus mu n by k. Okay, and complementary solution is again same, which is a cosine of omega n t minus phi. Now you have to combine these two things together to get x, and then you have to write down x as a cosine of, here it will be t1, okay, a cosine of omega n t1 minus phi plus this particular integral, which is minus mu n by k. So this is what is the expression of x. Now I have to find out what is a and what is phi. For that I'll be using initial conditions, which are x at time t1 equal to 0 is equal to minus of x0 minus 2 mu n over k. Okay. And velocity at time t1 equal to 0 is 0. You know that this is going to end up in phi equal to 0. Whereas what this is going to give you is x at time t equal to 0, t1 equal to 0 will be equal to a cosine of phi, where phi is 0, which essentially means that this will be 1, and this is minus mu n by k. Okay, so you have to evaluate this term at time t equal to 0, which won't change at all, so it will be that only. Okay, which should be equal to minus of x0 minus 2 mu n by k. Okay, which essentially means that a is equal to, so you have to take this term on this side. Okay, so it is minus x0 plus 2 mu n by k, 1 mu n by k will get added over here, and new a, that is for the second half cycle where mass is coming from left extremity to other extremity, that right extremity, at that time a happens to be equal to minus of x0 minus 3 mu n over k. Okay, and therefore you can write down x as minus x0 minus 3 mu n over k times cosine of omega n t minus mu n by k. This is what is the expression of x for the second half cycle. So let's try to see how that part looks like. So what is the expression? Expression of x is x0 minus 3 mu n by k times cosine of omega n t1. Yes, it is t1 here, which is nothing but t minus pi by omega. Let me just see to it whether it is right. What t1 that we have used? Yes. Minus mu n by k. This is what is the expression of x. Okay. So let's try to see how it looks like. So this is time axis t. Okay, first of all you shift along this time axis by this much amount, pi by omega. Okay, now at that instance, let's first of all plot this term itself. Okay, so what does this term tell us? This term tells us, yes, this is what is the expression. Okay, this is what is the function that will look like. Okay, which is, this is cosine function. It is starting from minus x0 plus 3 mu n by k, right? This point is minus x0 plus 3 mu n by k units away from this x-axis, that is this time axis, right? And this is what is the amplitude of it. However, you have this another term sitting over here, which is shifting this curve towards this side. negative side by units. How much units? Mu 1 by k. Okay, so you have to, whatever that you have obtained over here, you have to shift this entire curve. This entire curve will be shifted by this much amount. Okay, so essentially the curve, the new curve that you are going to get is, it will start at this time, which is pi over omega, and the new curve will be starting at minus x0 minus 2 mu n by k, and it will end over here. Okay, at this level, which is how much off from this time axis? It is minus, it won't be minus this time, sorry, it will be x0 minus 4 mu n over k. So this is what is the second cycle that we have obtained. We already have seen how was this first cycle. First cycle was like this, right? Actually, this distance and this distance should be identical, but the way I have drawn, it doesn't look like. Okay, so let me draw it neatly over here. Okay, so let me draw the first cycle and then the second cycle, second half cycle. So this is the first half cycle, which started from x0. Okay, it was a cosine curve and we came over here at this level, which was x0 minus 2 mu n over k minus of that. Okay, now we have to start another cosine curve from this level. Okay, and we have to go till this much distance. Okay, which is, how much is this? This is x0 minus 4 mu n by k. Sorry, this is k. Okay, so within one cycle, this is first half cycle, which is pi by omega. This distance is also pi by omega. So this overall cycle is 2 pi by omega. Okay, what is the period of this cycle? This is 2 pi by omega n. Right? And within this one cycle, how much reduction in the amplitude you have obtained? The reduction in the amplitude is 4 mu n by k. And you can keep doing this. Now in the next set, what you will be doing is you will be solving another differential equation for negative velocity, and that will give you this one. Okay, so you are going to end your journey over here. Okay, then in the next cycle you have to start from here and journey will end over here. Now in that cycle following to that, you are going to start from here and journey will end over here. So in each half cycle you are losing 2 mu n by k units of amplitude, and in each full cycle you are losing 4 mu n by k units of amplitude. So each complete cycle is responsible for this much amount of loss of amplitude, and this loss remains constant. So how much loss you have seen over here in the first cycle, same amount of loss you are going to see over here in the second cycle itself. So this damping is the nature of this graph. If you see, this is linear. So amplitudes, if you join them, then that comes out to be linear. Okay, this curve comes out to be linear. However, in the viscous damping that case, you have seen that curve was like this, exponential curve. It was not linear. Okay, although the differential equation was linear, but when you have joined the amplitudes of each successive cycles, then whatever that envelope that you have drawn, that envelope was non-linear over there. Whereas in this case, it is exactly opposite of that. The envelope over here is linear, but the differential equation we started with was non-linear. Okay. Now, one thing that you need to appreciate is that after some amount of time, what is going to happen? After some amount of time, after each cycle, you are losing the amplitude, and then let's say after r number of half cycles, this is what you end up with. Okay, x0 minus r times 2 mu n by k. So this is what is the distance of the mass block from this x-axis, that is this time axis. So this much is the displacement of the mass block, absolute displacement. If you see, how much is that? x0 minus r times 2 mu n by k. Now if this happens to be smaller than mu n by k, let's say that this happens to be smaller than mu n by k. So when displacement will be smaller than mu n by k, what will be the spring force that will be acting on that mass block? It will be k times this displacement, this displacement, which will be smaller than k times mu n by k, which essentially means that it will be smaller than mu n, which is the frictional force, right? So what you have done is you have kind of reduced the amplitudes to such a level that the spring force, which is trying to pull that mass block from that extreme position. See, whenever you are over here, whenever there is a shift, you are at the extreme position. At that position, velocity is zero always. Velocity is always zero. And you have non-zero displacement. Okay, so displacement is non-zero, but velocity is zero. So there won't be any kinetic energy associated with the mass. Okay, so who is going to pull the mass back to the mean position? It is only the spring force which has to do that job. And if it so happens that after certain number of iterations, the mass block is now has taken this position, for which the spring force which is acting on that mass block is smaller than the frictional force which it has to overcome. Okay, so mass has to, so this is the mass, okay, which is, let's say, displaced from the mean position, and this distance, this displaced distance is smaller than mu n by k. Okay, so how much is this distance? That is smaller than mu n by k. Then in that case, whatever spring force which will be acting onto it, k times this distance, that will be smaller than mu n. Okay, and hence that spring force is not sufficient enough to overcome the frictional inertia, the frictional resistance that is being offered to the motion of mass. So it essentially means that mass will cease its motion completely. Okay, the mass will stop over there. So where will the mass stop? When you are going to see this term, which is x0 minus r times mu n times mu n divided by k, that happens to be smaller than mu n by k for the first time. Whenever this happens, for that number, those many oscillations only will take place. Thereafter, there won't be any movement. Okay, so these many half periods have taken place. Afterwards, there won't be any motion of the mass. Mass will cease its motion over there. So where mass is going to cease its motion? It will either be over here at this extremity, or it will be over here at this extremity, but it will not be at the mean position. It will end its journey away from the mean position, slightly away. Obviously that distance will be very small, but it is not going to die down. Its motion is not going to die down when the mass is at the mean position. It is going to be off from the mean position, which is again kind of not very much consistent with the viscous damping that we have seen. So for viscous damping, what we have seen is that mass ideally never ends showing oscillatory motion. So till time tends to infinity, mass is showing oscillations, but amplitude becomes very small, and hence we say that okay, fine, mass has stopped completely its motion. And that is kind of an assumption. However, till time t tends to infinity, it continues its oscillation. Whereas in this case, which is this frictional damping case, you get to see that after certain finite time, mass stops completely. And mass doesn't stop at mean position, but it stops slightly away from mean position. So these are certain differences between these two mechanisms, damping mechanisms, that we have considered. So the first one was the viscous damping mechanism, and this is the Coulomb damping mechanism. There are other damping mechanisms as well. They can be fairly complex. However, we have considered only these two damping mechanisms from the perspective of this course. Okay, and once again, as I have been telling you again and again, whatever damping and spring what that we have seen so far, those are all symbolic. Okay, so you may see something very different which won't resemble with whatever spring mass damper, whatever that we are drawing over here, but that system's behavior can be modeled using these damping mechanisms, this kind of springs that we have seen over here. Okay, so these are idealizations of the realistic systems. Okay, so we'll be stopping over here for this particular topic, which is this dry friction damping, and from the next class we are going to start with force vibrations. Okay, thank you. Bye.